I was talking to you about various things that I've been doing, and I was started having one of those conversations where it's like, well, obviously I'm using this, and obviously that's happening, and obviously, and you said to me, well, that's not obvious. And I realized that there's this sort of, there's a hole in the Computerphile catalog. Other than Dave Brailsford very bravely trying to say that HTML5 is a Turing complete language, we haven't really discussed a lot of the set of HTML5, JavaScript and CSS as a whole range of technologies that are now kind of influencing everything. And much as this is old news for a lot of people, I thought this would be a good springboard to launch some other more specific videos from.
I'm reluctant to bring up Professor Brailsford's conversation with me all those years ago. But yeah, putting that to one side, things have moved on since that conversation, haven't they?
Well, they have. And the thing is they things were already in motion back then, but it's taken as ever, you know, someone invents something, but then it takes a while before it becomes just pervasive and sort of standard practice. And I wanted to write a plugin for Premiere because I'm doing a load of video editing at the moment. And when I downloaded the latest sort of SDK and I was sitting there going through doing some bits and pieces, I realized that there's this thing that's been in Premiere for quite a while, which I hadn't noticed, where you can write panels and effectively it's Chromium embedded and it's HTML5, CSS and JavaScript to be able to control these things. And this technology is just so pervasive now, and it kind of hasn't been covered at all.
Where do we start with this then? What's the first one you want to mention?
Well, we should start by saying, you know, there's a lot of things that are similar in ways, and there's certain terminology during this. So, for example, when I say JavaScript, a lot of stuff is also done in TypeScript, which is a more strongly typed version of JavaScript. But during this conversation, when I say JavaScript, it could also mean TypeScript. So we can't really get into the details of that. But I think the power of this technology is that anyone can access it for free. I mean, anybody out there who has any kind of computer at all can open up Notepad, type in some code, and do something. Run it in a browser or download Node and run it as a terminal application. And that's what makes it powerful. And it kind of reminds me of when I was 6 years old and starting on an Acorn Electron. I wrote my first program. You could type something, press enter, and something happened. And we kind of got far away from that with a lot of coding, particularly sort of like Windows-based and consumer PCs. And now with things like Visual Studio Code being just a free download and obviously a browser a lot more compatible now than they used to be, it's really easy for people to just have an entry point to doing something cool. And I really think HTML5, CSS and JavaScript are a really good entry point for people who've never done anything before, in the same way that BASIC was on an Acorn Electron or a BBC Micro or whatever back in the day. A lot of people don't realize there's loads of places where the HTML5, CSS and JavaScript family are being used. And one place that it's being used is in Visual Studio Code. If you go out on the net and watch these programming videos, so many people are using Visual Studio Code. I think it's the number one IDE. But that itself is based on a thing that used to be called Atom and is now called Electron, which I kind of like because of the Acorn Electron link there. But that is effectively a Chromium browser running with, you know, HTML5 and CSS and JavaScript, and you're kind of got this desktop app that's actually kind of like a website in a lot of ways, and it's web technology under the hood. So the story really starts with the Google V8 engine,
okay,
which kind of changed everything. It's a JavaScript engine. So back in the day when sort of JavaScript started, it was the Mozilla lot that sort of came up. It was a very simple scripting language so that it took the commands, processed them in real time, but obviously that's very, very slow. When Google were doing Chrome and Chromium, obviously the open source equivalent, they wrote a thing called the V8 engine, which did just-in-time compiling of JavaScript. So it would take the JavaScript, compile it so it ran a huge amount faster, and of course the JavaScript then was way faster than it had ever been before and actually became something that could to run proper applications from within a browser. Hence, we've now got Chrome OS and all these progressive web apps. And there's a guy called Ryan Dull back in 2009, so a year later after Google had released the V8, he took the V8 engine and said, well, what if we don't use it in the context of the web? What if we use JavaScript as the language and use their compiler, but we allow it to run terminal applications, like the old sort of command prompt on Windows or a terminal on Linux or Mac or whatever. We allow terminal applications to be written in JavaScript or TypeScript. And that really kind of changed the landscape for a lot of people, because a lot of people were writing websites where they'd have the HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and then that would talk to an API over the internet. And that API at the other end might be PHP or .NET or you know, Java server page or something like that. And it basically allowed you to write back-end code in the same language and same style as your front-end code. And it had some really good advantages. So JavaScript as a language is non-blocking. So a lot of traditional languages, so if you look at something like PHP or .NET or those sort of languages, they'll get the first command and then move on to the second, move on to the third. And it's kind of in line. And if you get to a bit where, say, you have to do a database lookup, it will go off and look up the stuff on the table, and it would wait for that and then come back and do the next line of code. And it would, yeah, top to bottom, down in
a kind of linear way, yeah? Like a bit like BASIC, I suppose.
Yeah, and process it like that. Whereas the way JavaScript is written is there's a thing called the event loop, where so what you do is you put what it needs to do in the queue. So you could send something off and say, go and fetch that data from the database, and then when it's finished, do this. And then while it's waiting for the database to come back, it can move on to the next things that it might do that are not necessarily linked with requiring that data. So the analogy that I've seen many times in videos on that is the equivalent of if you had a restaurant and there's many tables, and you wouldn't want a server coming to the table and saying, what can I get you for your meal? And they say, oh, I'd like steak and chips, please. And then he goes back to the kitchen and says, we need steak and chips at that table, and just waits there. With the JavaScript event loop and the way they queue up the commands, the server would go to the kitchen, say, he wants steak and chips. And then he'd come back and get the order from the next table and queue them up. And then when the steak and chips is ready, it would be put on the side and he can deliver it back to the table. And that allows it to get on and be able to have lots and lots of concurrent connections and to be able to cope with lots of little sort of micro tasks without being held up. And then if one database call takes a while, well, JavaScript will get on with other things until the database call's finished and it will come back, which makes it perfect for web technology. And of course, someone went, oh, well, Node.js, you know, that we can have that in the desktop and we can write apps like that. And then someone took Node.js, put the Chromium browser on top of it and said, well, this can be Electron, so you can write desktop apps which are cross-platform. And then you end up with VS Code, and you end up with Skype, and you end up with all these applications working on this technology. And people are using them like desktop apps and probably don't realize that at the core, it's just JavaScript and CSS and HTML. You know, it's just all the same stuff that's powering Gmail and Facebook.
It reminds me a little bit of technology that obviously, and actually I'll say happily, died out, Flash, right? Is there a similarity?
Right, it's interesting because, yeah, Flash was obviously was a closed system, whereas this is open. You know, Node is open source, Chromium is open source, Electron is open source, Visual Studio Code that Microsoft wrote is open source. All of these things are, it's the simplicity of it. You can get Notepad, you can get any Notepad thing or whatever the equivalent is in Mac or Linux, you can get that, any text editor, and just write something and run it, and it doesn't require a huge amount of overhead, whereas to write something in Flash or do something in Flash, you had to have the Adobe software to be able to create the Flash.
It was proprietary, right? That was the problem there, right?
Yeah, it's proprietary. It's so HTML5 and that killed Flash, thanks to pretty much Steve Jobs not including it on the iPhone and kind of said, no, we don't want to go that route. This isn't. And he was completely right, although people were angry with him at the time. He was completely right to kind of ditch the Flash technology. So yeah, all of that has come in and replaced what Flash used to do that would fill in, but in a much more set of open standards. And of course, because of that, the whole community's flourished and they've taken things that were never intended for use outside the web and put them on the desktop, and it's just stunning to see what you can do now. Node, which is really was the key after the V8 engine of being able to compile JavaScript, Node was the the thing that broke it out of just being web technology. But then from there, you had the Node Package Manager, which I'm sure a lot of viewers will have used, NPM, which is very similar to the way you'd use apt-get or whatever on Ubuntu, or you'd use any kind of repository, which allowed you to just install whatever node module you want. So if you want something that can root, so you get a web address, say /user/whatever, and you want it to run this piece of code when you get that URL, you can install Express. You know, it's very simple, one line, you install that module and it allows you. And again, it opened up a lot of opportunities for people who only had been programming in web technologies to suddenly be able to enter areas that they would have had to have learnt C or C++ or, you know, C# or something like that to do. The more you look round now when you turn your TV on and you see something come up, the more chances are that you're actually interacting with this web technology, which really has been a revolution since 2008 because of Google creating the V8 engine and then Node and these other sort of platforms that take use of that V8 engine. I love the fact that, you know, I started on Acorn Electron. The predecessor to that was the Acorn Atom, and now it's kind of like Atom and now Electron. It feels like there's someone having a nod back to those beautiful sort of early 80s days of British computing, which just, you know, just adds a bonus to me.
All we need now is someone running the Acorn and the Electron stuff on a Raspberry Pi, and the circle is complete.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. You can run. I mean, there are many people out there. I mean, I've written a couple of APIs that I use to control some things at home that are in Node that do run on a Raspberry Pi over Wi-Fi, and I can control various bits and pieces. I had something which was moving the knobs on my amps for me, so I could sit downstairs and turn up my amp, and then a little motor would turn the knob on my amp, and that was done via Node. Things that I never thought were possible to do, for example, putting a mixing desk in a browser and being able to have all the channels of a song and be able to turn up and down the bass drum and the snare drum, and there's the audio APIs that sit underneath the browser to actually do the hardcore stuff, but you're interacting with that with JavaScript and doing stuff that 20 years ago would have been just out of the league of someone like me to be able to write. You need a whole team of programmers to do, and now you can write it in a web browser. It's fascinating. I've bought the rights to use that picture and any derivative works from it. So if I then reverse engineer the audio from that picture, can I use the audio because it came from the picture which I
in this column? Because sometimes we mix diagonals, so it would be A, B, C, D, or A, B, C, D.